be here with you today. I'm delighted to see so many guests. We wish to acknowledge this land on which the University of Toronto operates. For thousands of years, it has been the traditional land of the Huron-Wendat, the Seneca, and the Mississaugas of the Credit. Today, this meeting place is still the home to many Indigenous people from across Turtle Island, and we are grateful to have the opportunity to work on this land. My name is Monica Wisher, and I'm the head of voice studies here at the Faculty of Music at the University of Toronto. And I would like to welcome you to this, the second event of three, in which we welcome Graham Johnson and Martha Guth to the University of Toronto as John R. Stratton Visitors in Music. Named for a great collector of vocal music and historical recorded sound, the John R. Stratton Visitor in Music brings distinguished specialists in the field of voice, opera, and collaborative piano to the Faculty of Music. We are so very grateful to Stephen Clark, the trustee of the Stratton Estate, for his generous support of the Faculty of Music. And, yeah. Indeed, so many thanks to give. Both of these artists, peerless in so many ways, have been lauded and have been busy in all the ways that you can read about via their extensive biographies. Because we have a wonderfully luxurious program today, I simply want to say that our good fortune, indeed that of all lovers of song, is that these artists, through their performances, their publications, and their sheer passion for song, ensure that it thrives in our midst. What a gift this is. Please welcome Martha Guth and Graham Johnson.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much. As I'm sure you're aware, there is a great deal of skill and planning that goes into events like this, and Martha and I are very aware of the hard work put in to make an event like this possible. So many thanks to Monica Wisher, who has seen us through the ups and downs, to Stephen Philcox of the Piano Collaborative Piano Faculty, to Stephen Clark, wonderful sponsor, and also to background people, to people I had delightful correspondence with, Laura MacDonald and Julia Barber in the Dean's Event Office. So all that goes into the making of what is effectively the Martha Graham Show. And for those of you who expected dancing, I'm sorry to abuse you. But there is dancing of a kind. Not physical dancing, but dancing to the music of time. That famous set of books by Anthony Poehl. And the music of time suggests that extraordinary thing that we all change, and musicians change just like every other human being. And we wouldn't be on in the school unless we were hoping for change. Expecting for change as we grow and get better at doing things. And the great composers have been very adept at that too, changing from within themselves, differences of style, and as they grow towards older age, they change. The music of Gabriel Fauré, well, his first songs were composed in 1862, and his last in 1921. So it would be very surprising if there wasn't a vast change in that. Benjamin Britten, so brilliant in his youth and younger years, died at the age of 63. Francis Poulenc, also just like Britten at 63, a few weeks after his birthday. And in those 63 years, they accomplished and managed to accomplish a sense of beginning, middle, and end. In the case of our first composer, Franz Schubert, he was denied older age. 5 years younger than Mozart, he died at the age of 31. The whole of our first half today is Schubert, who stands absolutely at the center of the Lieder repertoire, the song repertoire, in the same way that Shakespeare stands at the center of stage craft and theater. And just like Shakespeare, Schubert has an unbelievable ability to depict so many different types of people, and although he died at 31, so many ages. So we are beginning with the type of ages of man. We don't trace Schubert changing from his first songs in 1812 till his last 16 years later. Rather, his ability to depict change in the various stages of life. It's still all about growing from within, and understanding how there are different stages, and Schubert was a marvelous person at depicting older age and various states of being after death. But let's start with his mother singing to him, a Wiegenlied. He wrote a number of Wiegenlieder, and this one, much of the music in this program is not terribly well known. We're not giving you famous Schubert songs, but they are wonderful songs nevertheless. And this little lullaby has something about it that suggests his mother singing to him. And we know that his mother came from Silesia. She was not a native Viennese. And so that the folk music that she knew might have been nearer the music of Dvořák. Something haunting, something from real experience. A tiny little fragment of real life transposed into musical expression. We know very little about Schubert's boyhood. He certainly never was a great virtuoso like Mozart touring the world. At one point he wanted to work in the Graf piano factory when a cousin came to work there. But music, of course, was very early on a passion, as you would expect. It's just that nobody realized until a bit later what a great genius he was. But he seemed to have had a normal boyhood, and when he comes to describe the life of a boy, und der Knabe, he suggests how wonderful it would be in this boy's eyes to fly. But what's wonderful about the song for me is the element of looking at the world how it really is, and the way that he describes the fact that the boy is never going to fly. He realizes he is limited, that he is not born to be a bird as much as he fantasizes about that. And the acceptance, the gracious acceptance of life's limitations. It's famous that Schubert had problems with his father. The father had no intention of letting the boy be a composer if it meant that he was not working in the family business as a schoolteacher. Going through the early Schubert songs, one finds many, many references to fathers. In that most famous of Schubert songs, The Erl King, it is the father holding on to the son lovingly that the composer never had himself. We now get to a song of leaving home, and that was so difficult for Schubert. He tried again and again not to feel obligated to return, take his share in teaching. In those days, there was savage physical correction for schoolchildren. I should imagine that that alone was something that Schubert found reprehensible. So a song about fathers leaving home, the son trying to persuade the parents that it's in his best interest and their best interest to let him go. And even if they let him go into a great, beautiful land in another life, even if he doesn't make it, he will be safely in that most beautiful of lands, another life, and remember how much mortality there was at this time. Once out on the open road of life, there are so many trudging, journeying songs of Schubert, a composer who never journeyed very much, never seeing the sea, never leaving Austrian possessions, never going to France and England, which he most certainly would have done had he lived into his 40s. But he's wonderful at describing people walking. And when the theme is also moonlight and speaking to the moon, it's a wonderful recipe for musical success.
So heimatlos, so unbekannt.
Schubert is masterful right throughout his career in describing natural phenomena, above all the movement of water. We have the little brook in Die Schöne Mühlen. We have still lakes and rippled lakes and slight waves and bigger waves. The real sea is depicted very seldom, because he never knew it, and he tended to be a composer who talked about what he knew. But he had seen fast-running mountain streams, and in an extraordinary song that is way out of the normal in terms of his musical writing, in terms of the use of harmony, he describes the stream of life and how we are propelled through it, finding some level patches that at other levels tossed and turned. And he reflects this in an extraordinary panoply of changing harmony that Gabriel Fauré would have been proud of. Mysteries of Schubert's life is the lack of romance, the lack of a single person who loved him as much as he might love them, a huge documentary hole. Everything that is spoken about Schubert's romances with women has been made up and talked of long after his death. In many respects, a silent, secretive person, one senses also a guilt. But whatever, and there's nothing provable, and he intended us, perhaps, not to find anything out about him with absolute certainty. But the longing for a special person, runs through so many of his great songs, and also some of the songs that are hardly known at all. Like this one, and we've chosen some later strophes to actually talk about that stage in a person's life when the lack of love really appears to be disturbing and sad.
Ins Ohr.
our song that he wrote the first time he was able to leave home and live with his friend Franz von Schober in their house in the first district. And it's a description of an entire life cycle in various strophes. It's called Lebenslied, Song of Life. And in our program, it stands for all those middle periods of life and enjoyment and experience and learning before you have to confront your own mortality. End this program with three songs about mortality, and it's something, as you know, that Schubert had to confront very soon and unexpectedly. The first song, For Meine Wiege, with the text by Leitner, imagines a man in middle age looking at an old cradle where he had lain as a baby, and where he remembers vividly, or says he remembers, the bliss of being picked up and put to the mother's breast as she nurses him. And then feeling, who will look after him in this life when she goes? And it is true to say that our first intimations of mortality often occur as a result of parents' deaths. Then the song of Mignon, So Lasst Mich Scheinen. Character in Wilhelm Meister's Lehrjahre of Goethe is fading away. She says, I am dressed as an angel. It's actually for a fancy dress present giving to children. And she says to the children, let me remain dressed as I soon will be. There are levels of greatness in this 1826 song where we already feel the soul of Mignon going over to the other side. She is already halfway in those divine regions where she says she will soon be. And Schubert makes that abundantly clear. And to end, perhaps, the greatest masterpiece that isn't in the Pater's edition of Schubert's songs, excluded from them because the text by Novalis was considered outrageously strange. This is Novalis imagining himself having passed over and up and waiting for rejuvenation. It's a type of death which actually means dematerialization. You've heard the flowing river in Der Fluss. You will hear the flowing, bountiful milk of motherhood in For Meine Wiege. An extraordinary use of the water motif. And you'll also hear at the end of the Novalis setting, Der Verjungenden Flut, the youth creating, rejuvenating stream of death. And how Schubert manages to find musical solutions for this poem in 1820 that simply defy description. And it's a poem that remains fascinating for all sorts of psychiatrists and all sorts of archetypal psychologists. A very, very modern, great poem from the beginning of the 19th century. And now no one would ever stop this song from being in a complete edition of Schubert's songs. So three songs looking at death from different angles.
Als Kind.
gentlemen, thank you for reserving your applause to the end of this half. We now come to a very great song composer, and we are now going to see examples of different composers' styles, earlier and late, as they themselves develop. Fauré came as quite a young boy to study at the École Niedermeyer in Paris, and mastered an entire type of harmonic subtlety, because he studied everything in the church modes rather than ordinary major and minor keys, as at the conservatoire. And this gave his music right from the beginning an incredible richness. In his earlier years, he wrote some charming romances, light-hearted songs like Le Papillon et la Fleur. But at the age of 25, in reverting to his love of the church modes, the Lydian mode, his song Lydia is an example of the true Fauré revealing himself relatively early on in his life. The subtlety, the modesty, that trait he had of beginning songs with just chords on the same note or in the same pulse, and you think this is going to be dull, but from there unbelievable and extraordinary subtle flowerings occur. This is the period, by the way, that he was part of the salon of Pauline Viardot, where he met Gounod and a lot of other powerful people. And Pauline Viardot was persuading Fauré to write an opera, which he never did until much, much later in his life. And he was engaged to Pauline Viardot's daughter, Marianne, so was on the point of becoming part of Viardot's family. And I mention her name because she's becoming so well known as a woman composer in her own right. But he actually avoided that feeling of being sucked into a very, very, very strong household of opera. It wasn't where he was at his happiest. It's miniatures like this, every note, every thought, exquisite, that he began to make his fame.
Thank you.
be a mistake to think of Fauré's personality as in any sense related to that Grecian model of refinement in the Lydian mode. He was a very passionate person, extremely silent and difficult to get to know in many respects, but awfully charming for the ladies. And the middle of his life, in that middle period, there are a lot of marvelous, sometimes very dramatic songs to the poetry of Armand Silvestre. It would be something new when he discovered the poetry of Verlaine, but in that middle period, he provided what was really saleable in the music shops. But because he was Fauré, nothing is simple. There were many composers composing passionate songs about autumn, but this song has a subtlety of harmony that is literally unequaled. There is nobody else in the whole of music as we understand it that it would have made exactly these harmonic choices. It's this extraordinary thing that makes his music incredibly unique. In 1891, Fauré discovered the poetry of Verlaine and his Cinq Mélodies de Venise found him at last a poet full of music, full of clarity, full of economy that exactly fitted his style. And instead of wonderful songs from about 1891, and with the help of Verlaine, we get masterpieces. One of the most extraordinary sets of music cycles of all time was a work that he composed in 1896 on holiday, semi-holiday, just outside Paris in Bougival, where his neighbor was Madame Sigismund Bardach, Emma Bardach, an amateur singer, a soprano, and right under his wife's nose, Fauré fell in love with Emma, who was unbelievably excited by modern music, by mastery of harmony, by all sorts of amazing things. And in this music of midlife crisis, great, great work though it is, We see a man in his 40s showing every aspect of his ability with harmony to such an extent that it makes us almost giddy with the changes and with the profuse mastery that, as I say, it's a unique thing, his music, in terms of his use of harmony. It never stops, it changes with each half note. One gets a feeling of a shift of chord, pages and pages of an analysis necessary to tell us what's happening. And the overwhelming pleasure and desire of a man, unhappily married, with two sons, never to leave his wife, but enchanted by a woman who was unbelievably musical and who inspired him to write new pieces for every day of her visit. He couldn't marry her. She left him. She went on to marry Claude Debussy. So this extraordinary woman was quite certainly going to become allied with a great French composer. All those harmonies, all that passion. And suddenly when Fauré crossed into the threshold of old age, 12 years after composing that piece, he discovered the poetry of Charles van der Berg, a modernist Flemish poet, very much Art Nouveau period. And he wrote two masterpieces of cycles. And we're going to give you the opening song, Paradis, and the second song, Prima Verba, of the cycle La Chanson d'Eve, the Song of Eve, which purports to describe the cosmic figure of womanhood. And it's very much to do with the celebration of womanhood, that is Eve. In the process, Fauré dares to do nothing less than to present almost the creation of the world. And he also does something which I know of in no other song from the 20th century of this kind, the voice of God speaking. That he gets away with these things in music of incredible power that is so economical, that has so few notes, extremely well placed, it becomes something imponderable. this journey into older age of this great man, first of all, a student, then a lover, then a successful person in the salon, becoming increasingly as he goes through life more and more focused on an ideal and on the idea that less is more. From the very first note, we hear that this is a completely new phase in Fauré's music, and that he has not only entered older age, but has a voice, quiet though it is, unusual though it is, that will contribute to his immortality.
Thank you.
Francis Poulenc had grown up in the shadow of Fauré's music and disliked it. Many people felt that any music written before the war, the music of Debussy, the music of 100 other composers less great than Debussy, was expendable. Everything was the new Igor Stravinsky, the Ballet Russe, the 1920s. The first cycle that we're going to hear of Poulenc, Three Little Songs, was really his first cycle, written shortly after he'd composed his best year. So not quite the first cycle, but The first cycle to his text of Jean Cocteau. I must say that the silliness of this music, the fun, the sense of, well, dada, it's extremely throwing away deliberately all the old props of all the old music that used to move us, that used to be so subtle. And when this piece was composed, Fauré was still alive, still writing chamber music, on the point of writing his last cycle, but it's two different worlds. Cocteau relishes going over his own childhood for memories, and Poulenc, who grew up in exactly the same Paris at exactly the same level of financial comfort as Cocteau, remembers the world of childhood and excitement and circuses and everything that a well-pampered child born at the turn of the century would have had at his disposal. What an extraordinary time to have been born, and in what a city to be born if your destiny was to be a modern composer or painter or artist of any kind. Cocade is a post-war, post-First World War, he called it a celebration of being French. But it's also a celebration of being modern, and it's by a composer who hasn't yet found his voice. It's youthful, it's audacious, it's cheeky. It's what people called leg Poulenc. But it is, nevertheless, and we hear this in certain chord progressions, in certain aspects, the voice of the composer we love in his later work can be heard from time to time.
Bye. capisce prima cura.
Piece dates from 1920. Poulenc is perhaps one of the composers who changed the most from those early years of being an enfant terrible. He discovered the poetry of Apollinaire, lyrical about life in Paris, but it was in the 1930s when he met the great baritone Pierre Bernac and discovered the poetry of Paul Éluard at the same time, that Poulenc became a composer of the heart, no longer wishing to shock everybody, no longer willing to be à la mode at all costs. His particular piano style, his ability to take inspiration from so many things, so many composers, whether it was Chabrier or Chopin or Monteverdi or Palestrina, he somehow manages to make a melting pot which sounds every bit like Poulenc and only like. So the song that we have now is the middle period of Poulenc, from the middle of the First to the Second World War, a setting of Louise de Villemorin, and the lyricism, the liquidity, the understanding of what's right for the human voice, entirely lacking in Cocard, as wonderfully as Martha sang it. There's no doubt that he's worked with singers, understands singers, loves the human voice, loves the challenge of writing this poetry by a woman that he knew very well, Louise de Villemorin.
Thank you.
In his own way, as he reached his final years, which were unexpectedly cut short, he died suddenly of heart failure in 1963, age just 63. Poulenc, in his last cycle, and we're going to actually perform for you now the very last song he ever wrote, became a bit like Fauré, increasingly reserved, no longer the same plangent, luscious harmonies, everything more controlled, everything sadder, everything older. So actually, this is the very last song that he wrote. Now two songs to end our program by Benjamin Britten. An early song, setting of Hilaire Belloc. I think that he reworked the song sometime in his 20s, but the original sketch goes back to boyhood. And a later song, one of his few songs in German. He did a lot of a cycle of Hölderlin, but this is the only setting of Goethe he composed. He was envisaging a Goethe cycle sometime in the late 60s. But this is a world of modernism and visionary quality that we get in the late Fauré and the late Poulenc. Two songs by Benjamin Britten from completely different ends of his career.
When Jesus Christ was 4 years old, the angels brought him toys of gold, which no man ever had bought or sold.
We have just one tiny song that uses the same text that Britten said, O Mitternacht. And it's a song of such beauty and proof that other people in Schubert's time were writing songs, extremely beautiful songs too. You have the text. This is music by Goethe's greatest correspondent and friend, Carl Friedrich Zelter.
Thank you.